We are approaching our scheduled time. My name is Jessica Vionis. I'm the marketing coordinator here at Golden Helix, and it is my pleasure to once again get to introduce Dr. Bryce Christensen, who also gave the webcast in November on large NNGS analysis. So head over to our website and check that out if you haven't already. Bryce fills two roles at Golden Helix, as he is both the Director of Services as well as a statistical geneticist. Bryce joined GHI in 2009 from the University of Utah, where he earned his PhD in genetic epidemiology and biomedical informatics. Before undertaking his graduate studies, Bryce worked for 2 years as a data analyst at Mayo Clinic in the Division of Biostatistics. And with that, let's see if Bryce's audio is working.
Okay, can you hear me now, Jessica?
Yes, I can.
All right. So let's go ahead and get started then. Thank you, Jessica, for the nice introduction. When Jessica first approached me several weeks ago about giving a webcast on this topic, I must admit that my first response was to ask whether or not she thought there would be a large audience who might be interested, and I'm pleasantly surprised and happy to be proven wrong on this one. We did have, at last count, nearly 800 individual registrations for this particular webcast, which easily puts it among the most popular we've ever done. So hopefully you're all able to find something valuable in the content that we'll be presenting today. If you have any questions along the way, feel free to type them into the question window there in the GoToWebinar software. We may have time to answer a few of them during the presentation, but if not, we'll try to answer as many as we can at the conclusion today. So before we move on, just want to tell you a tiny bit about our company for those of you who may not know us as well. We have been in business for about 15 years now. Our software tools have been cited in over 800 published scientific articles. And in addition to our software business, which is what we're probably best known for, we also provide analytics services. Jessica mentioned that I have the title here of Director of Services, so I am closely involved in most of these analytic service projects we do. And over the past several years, I've been involved in several dozen, I can't really count at the moment, but several dozen GWAS projects. And a lot of what I'll be showing you today is based on the experience that I've had being involved with those various analysis projects through our services division. We'll spend a lot of time today looking at SNP and Variation Suite, which is our flagship software product. SVS is a platform for doing all types of genomic data analysis. We do everything from SNP GWAS that we'll be looking at today right up through DNA sequence analysis, copy number variation, RNA-seq. But what I really want you to pay attention to while we're in the software today is not so much the workflows I'll be following as the flexibility of the software and some of the individual functions. What I really want to do today is present a few particular functions and give some background on them, really from the perspective of the analyst, somebody who is actually working with this data and needs to know a little bit about where it comes from and why we do some of the things we do. GWAS has been going on now for about a decade or so, and there are a lot of practices that have just become standard, and I don't know if everybody really stops to think about why we do some of these things. So that's what I want to focus on today. As we go along, there will be three major sections of the presentation. We'll talk about quality control considerations in GWAS. From there, we'll move into some discussion of association testing. And given that imputation is becoming more and more popular and in some circles regarded a standard part of GWAS, we'll also talk about that a little bit and talk about what you should expect from imputation if you're doing it for the first time in particular. The data that we'll be looking at today is all simulated. The genotypes come from several different studies that are available through the NCBI GEO database. They all used either the Illumina 550K or 610 platform. I've just joined several of those together, and we're using simulated phenotypes. We'll get that out of the way up front, that we're not expecting to find anything in particular. Now, also, because we will be moving pretty quickly through the workflows today, and I know there may be people on the line who are more interested in particular parts of the workflow, I'll point out that if you go to our website at goldenhelix.com, you can watch some of the recorded webcasts we've given in the past that have more detail about different parts of workflows. For example, earlier this year, Greta Peterson, our senior biostatistician here at Golden Helix, gave a great presentation on mixed model analysis. There are other presentations we've given in the past that focus heavily on QC or on imputation methods. And this particular webcast at the top right about agrigenomics has a really nice discussion of population genetics and some of the functions available there. So I encourage anyone with further questions to go take a look at those if and when you have the time. So with that, without further ado, let's go ahead and close out of the slides for a minute and go straight into SVS. Now, I know there are many people listening today who are already very familiar with SVS. I know we have a lot of our current clients on the line. But for those who aren't familiar, I'll just point out that SVS is a platform for analysis and management of genomic data. It's very much project-oriented. It's designed to help you organize all of the inputs and outputs of an analysis project in one place. And I'm going to start by opening a project that already has some data in it. Now, if you're getting into GWAS for the first time, or maybe you've already been working with GWAS for a while, one of the first questions you'll have is about data formats. And if you want to use SVS, of course, it's very helpful to know what formats you need to get your data into the software. I'll just point out for now that in terms of import, we can handle all of the standard formats from Illumina, from Affymetrix. Also, we can handle the standard formats that are used in most of the open source and freeware tools. So for example, if you're using Plink and have the binary BedFam BIM format files, we can read those in with no problem and convert them to our native format. Once they're in the software, we support spreadsheet style views of all data types. And so this is the data that we're going to use for most of our discussion today. When I open this up and look at it, we can see immediately up at the top right that there are 499 rows and over 500,000 columns. I can scan down through, recognize that there is one row for every sample, and out through to the end, one column for every SNP. There's also an embedded marker map feature that tells us a little bit about each individual SNP here. And you'll recognize that for the moment, I'm limiting this data set to autosomes only. So we have chromosomes 1 through 22. Now, if I were a researcher who was looking at this particular data set for the first time, usually what I like to do is begin by looking at some sample level statistics, find out who these samples are, where they come from, and if there are any major features that distinguish them from one another. And one of the first places I would go then is here in the QA menu to look at genotype statistics by sample. I'll go ahead and run this with the default settings for now, but what it will do is calculate sample-wise call rates, autosomal heterozygosity statistics. If we had the sex chromosomes present, which I don't today, we could also look at X chromosome heterozygosity for gender inference. There are some statistics here that are specific to sequence analysis. So for example, transition transversion ratios are a very useful tool for sequence data quality. But anyway, we see this is finished up here now. Let's talk about what we can learn by looking at sample statistics. First off, we have this sample call rate, which I will just go ahead and immediately put into a histogram so we can see what the distribution looks like. So we look at this, we can recognize that the majority of samples are very consistent, have very high call rates up here in the neighborhood of 99% or higher, but we do have some samples with low call rate. What does that mean? In most cases, it's an indicator of DNA quality for the sample. It may also indicate something about quantification or something that happened in the laboratory handling of the sample. For now, we'll just recognize that we have several samples with low call rates. I'm not going to bother removing them yet because I still want to learn a little bit more about the data. Over here further, I have another statistic. It is going to be the heterozygosity rate from all of the autosomal columns. This one is useful in many ways to look at. As we look at this distribution, if I increase the bin count, we start to see a separation, a bimodality in the distribution. Typically, if you see a pattern like this, what it's capturing is some kind of population structure or ethnic stratification. I'll show some more examples in a few minutes of what happens when you have samples from different worldwide populations in your GWAS. But one thing to be aware of is that there are certain SNPs that are going to be highly polymorphic in one population, less so in another. So when you look at heterozygosity rates from population to population, you'll see this kind of stratification occur. Another interesting feature is that we do have some very high and low outliers here. That can be an indicator of sample quality, especially the high outlier up here. That is most likely a sample that is going to be contaminated with DNA from another source. You can imagine that if you have two different DNA sources going into a sample, a lot of SNPs that might be homozygous in one sample or the other will appear to be homozygous in the pooled sample. And so this is a potential quality problem. And just so we know which sample that is, let's sort here and remember that it's this GSM640693. It might come back up later on. So now that I've seen a little bit about the data, I know that call rates are generally good. There's possibly some stratification here. What I'd like to do is dig into that a little bit more and find out what else I can determine about that stratification issue. And the obvious place for that is principal components analysis. Now, prior to doing principal components analysis, it's going to be helpful if instead of using this entire set of 500,000 SNPs, if we can reduce it to a subset that is a lot smaller but also very informative. So I'm going to apply a few filters onto this spreadsheet. So use this tool for genotype filtering by marker, and I'll keep it pretty simple. I'm going to require a 99% SNP call rate, 5% minor allele frequency. So that's going to give me SNPs that are well called and that are relatively polymorphic with at least a 5% minor allele frequency throughout this data set. So this will take just a moment. And when it's done, you'll see two things happen. First, we're going to get a report spreadsheet. And in that report spreadsheet, we'll see all of the SNP by SNP call rates. So here they are, call rates and allele frequencies are the two things that we calculated. Then also in the data spreadsheet in the background, we see that many columns have turned from black to gray. And that's the visual indicator that those columns failed the thresholds that I set. There's also an indicator column here specifying, for example, the SNP in row 2 failed. I can see that it failed because the call rate was less than 99%. It was at 97.5, so still good, but below what I required this time. Now, it is sometimes helpful to look at distributions of these statistics as well. So if you want to see that the SNP-wise call rates correspond with the sample call rates, they usually will, at least on the high level like this. We can see, again, that the majority of SNPs are very well called. There's just a few down here in the lower tail that have some problems. Now, if we come back here to this reduced set of SNPs, so we have 325,000 that are both high call rate and relatively high minor allele frequency. I can just create a subset of those. So I'm just going to pull out this set of filtered SNPs and apply one more useful little filter here. And the filter that I want to apply is based on linkage disequilibrium pruning. I'll adjust the parameters here just to make it go faster. We'll use a smaller moving window and a larger increment. But what I want to do is restrict it just to SNPs that have a maximum pairwise LD, or kind of a correlation from SNP to SNP, of 10% based on R squared. So we'll go ahead and run this. And so what it's doing is scanning through the remaining 325,000 SNPs. If it identifies a pair of SNPs within a 30 marker window that are highly correlated, it will keep the first, drop the second, and move on. I expect that when we're done here, we'll probably have in the neighborhood of 35 or 40,000 SNPs left. Now, why are we applying this? Well, number one, I already mentioned that I wanted to get to a smaller set of SNPs so that principal components will run faster. But beyond that, you will find that you get slightly different answers when you use a universal SNP set versus something that's been pruned based on linkage disequilibrium in your principal components. The difference might be subtle, but it is important, and especially when you have large blocks of SNPs that are in really strong LD with each other, it can confound the principal components calculation. It can confound other calculations as well. But here we get an indicator that 287,000 markers were inactivated. We see that we have 38,000 remaining. I'm going to make one last subset here and rename this spreadsheet. Let's call it LD pruned. And we're ready to go on from here. So if we look back at our project navigator, a few things I'd like to point out about the software. First of all, you'll notice that as we have gone along, it's keeping pretty detailed notes on each step. So we can see when we ran sample statistics, it keeps notes on how many markers were included there. When we run the genotype filtering, it keeps notes on what parameters were set, how many SNPs passed and failed. But it's also keeping sort of this hierarchical tree model of all of our data sets. So starting from the study genotypes, we produced a report of filtering results, did a call rate histogram based on that. Everything's visually connected. Ultimately, we end up with this set of LD pruned SNPs. I also happen to have in the project here a reference panel where we have samples from different parts of the world. And I'd like to include this in my principal components analysis to give me some point of reference on where my study samples are coming from. So coming back to my LD prune subset, I'll go ahead and append these two spreadsheets together, and I'll just tell it to drop any SNPs that aren't present in both spreadsheets, so we should get the same set of SNPs that I've already filtered and pruned here, except instead of having our 409 study subjects, we're going to have over 1,000. So here we are, we have 1,126. And we'll start up principal components, and then I want to show you a slide while we're letting that run. So principal components analysis, I'll just run it with the defaults. The method here is based on eigenstrat for anyone who's interested. But I want to point out that there's a great paper that appeared about 3 years ago in the journal Genetic Epidemiology. This comes from the Geneva Consortium. And it's one of the most comprehensive papers I've ever seen with regard to quality control in GWAS. They outline a very thorough procedure for doing QC on both samples and SNPs prior to proceeding with the GWAS, and I highly recommend that you look this up if you're just getting involved with a GWAS study. I'll also point out that everything that they describe is possible to do within SVS. So I believe now, if we back up, looks like our principal components is just about done. And in regard to that Geneva paper, I'll also point out that the procedures they outline would take longer to run through than what we have time to do in this particular webinar, so I am cutting a few corners with this. All right, so principal components finished up. And we see we have two outputs. We have the eigenvalues associated with each of the first 10 components. By default, it just calculated the first 10. Then also we have a spreadsheet with the individual principal component vectors. These vectors can be used in different ways. Of course, we can use them for visualization purposes if we want to see the spatial relationships between the samples. We also can use them as covariates in regression analysis if we want to adjust for the population stratification, if there is any. I want to visualize them, but I want to see them in the context of their population. I already have a spreadsheet prepared that has some population data in it. So if I proceed now and plot the first and second components into a scatter plot, I see this kind of classical triangular pattern that we see quite often in principal components analysis, but I can also see that there's a lot of variability in here. And to learn more about this, let's just recolor based on a few different variables and see what's going on. This source variable should tell me which are my study population and which are from the reference panel. So the green points are my study population. I see a pretty good concentration down here in the lower left, also a very distinct concentration here at the upper left, and some along here that are admixed. If I look at this region variable, I can see now that this reference group out here, let's just go ahead and split this. So this reference group out here in blue are the African samples. And so my green study samples that are scattered across here probably have some African-American admixture, something like that. If there's a particular sample I want to learn more about, I can click it. I get a link back to the spreadsheet. It'll highlight that particular sample. I can scan through and see, well, this is one of my study samples, and I don't know any more about it than that, but it's probably, I would guess, African-American from looking at this. Now, up here at the top, where I had another large concentration of samples, the reference samples there are the orange, which are from East Asia. So it looks like I have in my sample a pretty good cluster of Europeans together with a very distinct group of Asians and some admixed, probably African-American type samples showing up here. So with that, knowing that, in a typical GWAS, you would have some decisions to make at this point. Do you want to reduce your data just to those that are ethnically cohesive, homogeneous? Do you want to proceed with your study and apply some kind of a correction factor? For now, we're going to just proceed, but we still want to look at a few more things in terms of sample quality. The last thing that I want to look at here, if we come back to this spreadsheet that has our LD pruned SNPs. So I want to look at the pairwise relatedness between all of these samples. Again, we have about 500 samples here. I just want to see if there's any family structure involved. I'm hoping there's not. But there's a tool here for identity by descent estimation. I will go ahead and run this with the defaults. I'm going to turn off this one. It'll save us a little bit of time. Go ahead and let this run. Now, this is going to take a few minutes. It's calculating pairwise relatedness based on an allele sharing model. It's looking at the allele frequency of each SNP, determining the expected rate of sharing based on the allele frequency and comparing that to what's actually observed from sample to sample. But while we're letting it run here, I have some comments that are pertinent to both IBD and some other types of functions. As you look at this slide, the histogram on the left shows the autosomal minor allele frequency distribution of the old AFI-500K GWAS chip based on having a broad range of worldwide population. So it's all of HapMap phase 2. You can see that pretty much all of the SNPs are polymorphic there. But if you just take one of the populations, for example, the Asian population, you'll see that a large number of the SNPs are not polymorphic. And it should go without saying that GWAS chips are designed to capture global variation, and homogeneous cohorts will only be polymorphic for some subset of the SNPs. But it is a question that comes up surprisingly often, especially with people doing GWAS for the first time. They might come to us and say, you know, I've got the Illumina 5M. I should have 5 million SNPs here, but in my sample, I've only got 1.5 million that are polymorphic. Is that normal? And in fact, that is very normal. There are diminishing returns with increased marker density on chips. This is a similar set of plots, but this time a much higher density array, the Illumina Omni 2.5 with about 2.5 million markers. You can see with this one, even with a broad international cohort, there's a lot of SNPs that are not really polymorphic there. There's a lot of rare content that's being captured on the high density arrays. And if you restrict it just to the Europeans, and these histograms are on the same scale vertically, you can see, again, there are even more of them that are not going to be polymorphic there. So it's something to watch out for. Now, a related issue is if instead of looking at allele frequency in the autosomes, what if you look at heterozygosity on the X chromosome? And this particular example, unfortunately, isn't a really stark comparison, but it's good to pay attention to the design of the chip as you're getting into your QC. It looks like IBD is finished. And you'll notice here with X heterozygosity, you should be able to clearly separate between males on the left and females on the right. As you go from the AFI 500, the Omni 2.5 has a little bit more rare content, and the overall heterozygosity dips down. But I've seen experiences, especially with targeted chips, things like the immunochip or the cardiometabochip, where the X chromosome isn't necessarily designed to capture broad variability. It's has a lot of more rare content or disease-specific content, and you look at it and you can barely tell the difference between males and females. And that's a question we've gotten several times in tech support is, what's going on with my data? We have to ask, what chip are you using again? That's your explanation. And so why care about chip design? Just want to point out that many sample statistics are based on allele frequencies, and because the content from chip to chip is different, some of those statistics behave differently. So things like PCA, autosomal heterozygosity that we've looked at. Runs of homozygosity is different from those in that it's more of an analysis than a QC procedure, but it should go without saying that if you have a lot of rare content, you're going to be enriched for homozygous genotypes, and you will find more homozygous runs than you would otherwise if you have a high-density chip. Now, again, many of those statistics assume you're using a GWAS chip, something that's assessing global variability, and those statistics then can be confounded a little bit when you're using more targeted chips. I already mentioned the experience with X heterozygosity. It also applies to some of these other things. So the story here is to adjust your workflows accordingly. All right, with that, let's come back over to SVS and see what we learned from the IBD analysis. So we have a few different outputs here. The one that I'll focus on is this spreadsheet called estimated pi. You'll see that it's created a square matrix where each individual sample is compared to every other sample, and so each cell in the matrix is giving us the proportion of alleles that appear to be coming from common ancestry. And what I like to do is visualize this. Just put it into a heat map. Let's adjust the coloring a little bit. And we'll say unrelated will be white, highly related will be red, and we'll call that good enough for now. You should see two particular features on this heat map that really stand out. The first is these two heavy streaks of color at the top. The second is this block of color at the bottom. And let's talk about what each one is. This at the top, whenever you see this kind of a streak where you have one sample that appears to have excess background relatedness with every other sample, it's usually an indicator of contamination. Remember we mentioned earlier with the autosomal heterozygosity that an increase there could indicate contamination. Same thing here, where if a sample has a lot of heterozygous genotypes, they are then more likely to share alleles with other samples, and this kind of pattern pops out. You'll notice this is the same ID that we saw with the really high heterozygosity, so 640693. So more than likely a contaminated sample. And it looks like we may have one other here that's a little bit sketchy in that regard. But if we come down to this bottom corner, this is another feature. The first time I saw this was a few years ago when we were doing a GWAS with a client in the southwestern United States where most of their samples were Caucasian, but they had not informed us that there was a subset of samples that were Native American. And when we first ran this, and let me just add in an intermediate color to make it a little more obvious what's going on here. When we first ran this, we saw this block of samples that had background relatedness with values similar to this, where you click around and you see all these people that, when you look at the IBD estimate, it's somewhere between second and third degree relatives, but really kind of funky and hard to explain. It turns out that what we're seeing here is that block of Asians that we saw in the principal components plot. Because the IBD estimate is based on observed versus expected rates of allele sharing, and there are some alleles that are rare in the majority of the population, but more common here, the fact that they share those alleles based on ancestry, or ethnicity really, makes them appear to be more related than everyone else, and so you see that block of color jumping out. So again, something to watch for. One of the assumptions of the IBD algorithm is that you have an ethnically homogeneous population, and when you do not, things like this can happen. So with that, I'd like to wrap up our conversation about QC and talk a little bit more about analysis. And typically, I might spend some time now reviewing individual samples to be dropped out, or I might dig deeper into SNP-level QC, but I just want to plow ahead and open up this spreadsheet where I have some basic phenotype data. So I have two simulated phenotypes and a gender variable. Merge this up with the study genotypes and get ready to run an association test. So data merges are quick and easy in SVS, just a few clicks. And we've got everything in one place now when we're ready to go. I want to focus on phenotype 2 to begin with. So when I click it, it turns this pink magenta color that indicates it will be the dependent variable for any test that I run. And we'll go to the association test. Actually, I'm not going to go there yet. We're going to apply a few quick filters first. So we'll do similar to what we did before with the call rate and allele frequency filters, maybe be a little bit more permissive on allele frequency, but we're going to add in a filter based on Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, and we'll apply that only to the controls and let this run. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about these filters and where they come from. I think that there's a lot of inertia in GWAS. And people use some of these filters and don't necessarily recognize why. Call rate filtering, of course, is really about SNP level quality. If you have a particular SNP that is poorly designed on the chip or has other quality problems, it'll have a low call rate. That's why we're dropping this out. Allele frequency has two different sides to it. On the one side, it's about statistical power. Really rare alleles are not going to have good statistical power to compare with a phenotype. But also, older genotyping chips, especially, and to some extent newer chips, have known quality problems when it comes to calling rare alleles because they use clustering algorithms to look at the signal data and determine what the different what the different genotype groups are. If something is really rare, the clustering algorithm won't perform as well. And so it was instituted historically, I think, more as a QC procedure than something to do with statistical power. Hardy-Weinberg is kind of the same way. If you go back in time to some of the earliest large-scale GWAS studies, some of the original Wellcome Trust studies, they had thousands of spurious associations, which they were able to trace to quality issues with the early GWAS chips, where one allele or another was being called more frequently than it should. And the Hardy-Weinberg filter was discovered as a nice way to figure out the biases that were on the chips. And my own preference these days is to do minimal upfront QC. I like to run my association tests and then look at the best results in the context of their QC variables to decide which ones I trust. But there are differing opinions on that. Anyway, our filter's finished up. We see we get this similar report like we saw last time. And also we see we're reduced now to about 347,000 SNPs that we're actually going to use for our association test. So I will subset this down, come to my association testing menu, and I think what I'll do today, there are options for different genetic models. With each model, there are different test statistics available. I'll go ahead and run an additive model with a Cochran-Armitage test. I definitely want to calculate the lambda here because I'm suspicious that the ethnic stratification might be inflating my statistics. And we'll make sure to get some allele frequencies together with p-values. So there's a lot of flexibility in terms of the output that you get from the association tests here. This will go very quickly. Again, we have 350,000 SNPs, about 500 samples. So in GWAS terms, in modern GWAS terms, this is very small. But hopefully you recognize that the software is optimized to be very fast with the GWAS type analysis. So when we have our results here, we can sort and based on p-value, bring to the top our best results. RS209, that's a nice easy one to remember. You can see that the map information carries forward here. We recognize it's on chromosome 7 together with, looks like, some supporting information from nearby markers. That's good. Scrolling across, we also see the overall minor allele frequency at 33%. It's elevated to about 43% in cases, 23% in controls. So obviously there's some kind of a difference there that hopefully is not random. If we want to look at this a little bit closer, of course, most people prefer to immediately go to a visual summary. So I can plot my p-values in a Manhattan plot. So I see everything in its genomic context. Clearly, it looks like there's a peak coming out on chromosome 8. I can zoom in a little bit closer here and start to learn more about the genomic context of this result. So I can see, let's get just a little bit closer. Looks like we're in a gene called JAS-F1. I can click the individual SNP and get a link back to the spreadsheet if I want to go look at it closer. I also get links out to external databases. Now this is opening up on my second monitor, but by clicking there, I can come right into RS209 and see it in UCSC. Also, we have the ability to add additional annotations within the software. So if you want to see this in the context of the UCSC GWAS catalog or OMIM genes or anything else that you might find useful with GWAS, you can see that this JAS-F1 gene looks like has been associated with endometrial tumors, but also there have been the previous GWAS study that reported something right here for prostate cancer. So that looks like potentially an interesting cancer result. Now, of course, one thing we didn't look at yet is what about that population structure? Did it affect our result? And if we back up a little bit and look at our association test, you'll notice that there was a note put in the log that the lambda inflation factor is about 2.7, more or less. That's pretty severe. And if we want to see what that really looks like, whoops, wrong spreadsheet. Come back to our test results. We can plot the expected and observed log 10 p-values against each other. And come back here and add a diagonal line so we can see what it should look like. So what we have here is a pretty severe inflation of observed significance versus expected. We generally expect in GWAS that all of the, or not all, but the majority of the genome is going to be randomly distributed with respect to the phenotype. Here, obviously, the majority of the genome is not random with respect to the phenotype, which is why we're seeing this. The inflation factor, 2.6, is very high. The kind of the rule of thumb is you don't want anything above 1.1. So it's something that we need to consider. And we do have a pretty good assumption here that the inflation is the result of the population structure. There are other things that can cause it. But given that we know we have some population structure present, if we come back to our main spreadsheet, we have the option now to apply some different types of correction methods. And given the time, I'm just going to use one of them, although it is one that's rather time-consuming. But in the analysis menu, we have this option. It's one of the newest functions that we have for GWAS called mixed linear model analysis. And with mixed model analysis, the main concept here is that we're using the pairwise relatedness between samples, which we already calculated with IBD. We're using that as a random effect in a mixed model regression. And so we're accounting for the actual pairwise patterns of allele sharing. And so if we use the mixed model option here, and we'll use the MX method. I'll talk more about that while we're letting it run. And select our kinship matrix that we've already computed. We do have the option of including additional fixed effects as covariates. And so if I had my principal components merged in here, which is perfectly reasonable to do, but would take an extra minute or two, I'll go ahead and adjust for this phenotype 1 as a fixed effect. And we'll let everything else go like it is and make sure we get information for a QQ plot. And let this go. Now this is going to take a few minutes to run. It's a two-step process. So while it's going, I want to back out a little bit. And I'll show just a few more slides here. And most of these come from the webinar that Greta Peterson gave earlier this year about mixed model analysis. And if you look at the history of GWAS over the last decade or so, we started out using mostly naive association tests, so simple contingency tables, linear and logistic regression, and so on. But it quickly became evident that there were factors like batch effects, population structure, even control sharing that can violate some of the assumptions of those naive tests and result in some pretty severe confounding. We saw an issue there with this population structure in this particular sample that was really leading to some major inflation of significance. And another thing is that over the last several years, the sample sizes we're seeing in GWAS are growing by leaps and bounds. And with larger sample sizes, those stratification effects become more and more pronounced. And agrigenomics goes without saying, if you have a non-random mating population, these things get even worse. And it turns out that in agricultural applications is where a lot of the interesting innovation has been going on in this regard. Earlier this year, I think it was in January, in Nature Reviews Genetics, there was a great article that addressed this. And they make a rather elegant argument that population structure itself is not a problem in GWAS. We always blame it on population structure, but if you really dig into it, it's a combination of environmental factors and the genetic background of a population. The difference is subtle, but it's important. And when we calculate principal components, that can serve as a proxy for both of these things, but it doesn't entirely explain either one. And the solution that they propose is exactly what we're doing here. So account for pairwise sample relatedness in a mixed model approach. And the general overview is you do exactly what we've done. You start out by calculating a kinship matrix that defines pairwise relationships, include that as a random effect in your model. You also can include other fixed effects in the model, but it allows, you know, and this is one of the really cool things about it, it allows you to mix and match both population-based and family-based cohorts. And that's the one thing that I've really been excited about with this particular method as I've learned more about how to use it. One of my favorite examples of this comes from the Wellcome Trust Part 2 multiple sclerosis study. This was a really large GWAS published about 2 years ago now, where they had 10,000 cases, 17,000 controls, worldwide Caucasian populations. The problem they had is that the controls weren't very well matched geographically with the cases. For example, in the United States, they had 1,300 cases, but over 5,000 controls. In Australia, they had a pretty good number of cases, but no controls at all. When you look at the principal components plots, they're all Caucasian, but you can overlay this on a map of Europe and see that you're starting out in Scandinavia, coming down through continental Europe, you end up in the Iberian Peninsula. And when they ran a regular naive GWAS on this, the inflation factor was similar to what we have here. It was about 2.5. And the supplementary materials online for this paper tell a really fascinating story about how they went through the whole analysis process. The supplementary materials are always the best part of papers in my experience. But they did a standard PCA adjustment, reduced their lambda to 1.2, so getting closer to acceptable range. Then they tried something really fancy. They stratified the analysis into ancestry-matched subgroups. They ran the analysis individually within each subgroup, then combined them all in a meta-analysis, and that made it worse, lambda of 1.4. They then went back to the drawing board, coded up their own mixed model approach, very similar to the framework that we're proposing here. Their lambda was reduced to 1.04. That was the result they ultimately published on, and turned out that was probably about the only approach that would really work for them with this particular data type. So within SVS, there are several different approaches available to account for population structure. One that's not even listed here is just a genomic control correction based on the lambda statistic, regression with principal components correction. We didn't have time to show that today. Then there's the MX method, which is a mixed model approach. And the MLMM is kind of a stepwise implementation of MX. So it runs multiple iterations there, assuming there will be several associated loci within the data. So it identifies the SNPs that are important cofactors that will help you to identify the association of other SNPs. And the GBLUP method, that is a statistic that calculates an allele substitution effect. That one is particularly useful in agrigenomics. So with that, hopefully, we're close to being done back here with our mixed model approach. Looks like we have just a minute or so to go. And while we're waiting for this, I'll just look at some of the questions that have come in. One question that came in a little earlier when we were looking at the principal components and the IVD, why don't we see a section on the heat map for the African American samples? Number one, I only ran it on the 500 study samples. There were a handful of African Americans, and in fact, they were there. They were up at the top left, but there were only 5 or 10 of them, so the clustering wasn't really obvious. We can go back and look at that in a minute. There's another question about data export. I'll point out that yes, every spreadsheet that we create, every plot that we look at, can be exported in different formats. So this finished up. So we now have the results of our mixed model analysis. And the first thing I'd like to look at with the mixed model analysis is what happened with the inflation. So I'm immediately just going to draw up a QQ plot here, expected and observed log 10 p-values. And it looks like we have definitely done a pretty good number on that. So this kinship matrix correction appears to have worked. And it looks like we still have some SNPs that hopefully are showing us a true signal. So to look at that, I can come back in, put my p-values in the browser. See, now on chromosome 7, it looks like maybe there are two independent signals here. If I want to compare that to what we had previously, I can come back and find the original association test just from the naive model, add in that log 10 p-value, and you can see clearly now how much we've reduced the background noise by using the mixed model approach. Also, we can see that the SNPs that were significant have actually improved their signal a little bit. Just to emphasize that, definitely we've come up above the noise. So I'd love to spend some more time there, but the bottom line is that population structure does not have to be a dead end in your analysis. So just a few final points I want to mention in regard to GWAS. We often hear arguments about whether or not GWAS is dead. We also hear arguments about missing heritability in GWAS, and that's one of the great criticisms, is why are things missing that should be there based on statistical analysis? And there's a few points I want to bring up. This first one, GWAS is typically based on tag SNPs. We don't expect that the causal variant for a disease is going to be on our chip. So we're testing for the association between A and C, assuming that A is going to be correlated with this untyped causal SNP. Now, the statisticians in the room might look at this and get a little bit suspicious, and they say, but wait a minute, correlation's not transitive. And that is, if A and B are correlated, here it's an LD relationship, and B and C are correlated, A and C mathematically are not necessarily required to be correlated. And if you pull out a statistics textbook or go on Google and dig around for a while, you'll find that there are methods where if you know the correlation from A to B and B to C, you can calculate the range of possible values for the correlation between A and C. And as long as these are both pretty high, they're usually going to, you should be able to identify the relationship. And also I'll point out that the LD relationship between A and B is different than just plain old Pearson's correlation. There is a more structured relationship between SNPs on a haplotype. But it is a question, and it's one that I've heard come up, but perhaps not often enough. I think it is something that can explain some of the missing heritability in GWAS. And it's a known weakness, but I wouldn't call it a major problem so much as a cost-benefit trade-off that we're willing to make, because GWAS is not nearly as expensive as sequencing. But an extension of this, though, is what does it mean for imputation? Because with imputation, we are estimating the genotype at B based on the LD relationship, so is it really any different? And the one thing I want to point out is that usually with imputation, we're actually estimating this genotype based on not just one observed SNP, but several. There's a more complex haplotype structure going on there. And so in my experience, imputation is usually very accurate. And when you have an accurately imputed genotype, that could be the best available alternative to sequencing, and a lot cheaper. But as always, sometimes I'm labeled a cynic for speaking this way, but always, 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 you have to follow up on anything that looks significant. And when we talk about what to follow up on in imputation, just a few tips here. Imputation programs all have some kind of accuracy metrics. And it's important to review those, and especially to look for inter-cohort differences. So if you have several different GWAS studies that you're imputing so that you can have a meta-analysis or some way of directly comparing them, those inter-cohort differences in quality are very important to look at. And, you know, what kind of quality scores are we using with GWAS? There's one example here I'm showing on the screen, which is the R-squared statistic from Beagle. What it's really measuring is the noise in allelic dosage. So if those of you who are familiar with imputation know that typically the output you get is capturing a kind of a probabilistic genotype where you're either close to zero if it's homozygous for one allele, close to one for a heterozygote, or close to two if you're homozygous for the opposite allele. And with the R-squared statistic, if it's really high, so here nearly 100%, you see there's very little noise. Every genotype is imputed pretty clearly as either being homozygous, heterozygous, or homozygous for the minor allele. While with reduction in that statistic, you see there's a little bit more noise, get down to something around 39%. There are a lot of samples where it just does not know how to impute that particular individual. A point right in here would indicate that it's either heterozygous in the middle or homozygous for the major allele, but not really sure. And this kind of a distribution can still be compared to a phenotype and give you an idea of whether there's a dose-response relationship between genotype and the outcome variable you're testing. But if you have one of these lower quality signals like this, you absolutely need to follow up on it and see if you can get better accuracy on what that genotype should be. Another thing I'll caution you to watch out for imputation is something that affected the first imputation study I was ever involved with, where the imputed allele frequency was very different from what was observed in the reference panel. And this is just one chromosome from an imputation study where we've plotted the imputed allele frequency compared to what was observed in 1,000 genomes. And you see some down along this axis. These are problematic, where the imputed frequency is high, but in the reference panel, that's a very rare SNP. There's something going on there. But more importantly, in my mind at least, is this axis over here, where it's common in the 1,000 genomes, and that's what you're using as the reference for imputation, but it imputes at zero frequency, and that's a result of just not having the supporting structure in your GWAS data to impute those. And that first imputation study I was involved with, just to summarize what happened there, we had a situation of looking at Alzheimer's disease. We knew that APOE is very important there. The client had separately genotyped a couple of known Alzheimer's SNPs that were not on the 500K Affymetrix platform. When we ran the GWAS, we could see that those SNPs they genotyped separately were very, very significant. And we asked the question, could we have imputed those? And in that particular situation, it would not have worked. When we ran the raw GWAS, right here in the middle is where that SNP should have been. Of course, it wasn't there in the raw GWAS. When we tried imputation, we did several different imputations with different reference panels. We were never able to impute it. If we just included it with the GWAS data, of course, we were then able to impute a lot of supporting SNPs around it. So it's one of those situations where even though imputation is advertised as being great for imputing common SNPs, sometimes it can miss common SNPs as well. So watch out for it. Now, finally, I just want to bring up this question of why do imputation? And when you talk to people, you hear, I think, four major categories. I would say the first three here are the ones where you really get value. So filling in the blanks, improving your call rate with the GWAS, or increasing the density of genotype calls to help you define or refine the search space, The third one, I would say, is the single most valuable use of imputation to harmonize different array platforms for mega-analysis or meta-analysis. And that is something that's especially popular in disease consortia. It's great to get that larger sample size. But if you are doing imputation with the expectation that you're going to observe something that you didn't see in your GWAS, I'll just warn you that that is very rare. And this last point is something that keeps me up at night, which is remembering that the reference panels we're imputing to are usually made up of pretty healthy people. We don't know their phenotypes, but we know they're not really enriched for a particular disease. So if there is some rare or moderately rare variant that's causing it, it's never going to be imputed based on the reference panels we have available today. And there's other implications of that. I'll let you all sleep on it, and maybe we can talk about it another time. So SVS, in regards to imputation, I'll point out that we don't have an imputation algorithm implemented inside the software, but we do have the ability to read and write and interact with the file formats used by the major imputation platforms. And we can do analysis on allelic dosage formats and other imputation outputs. So, quick review of what we've talked about today. GWAS is not dead. Hopefully you've been able to see that the SVS platform is very powerful and very flexible for GWAS analysis and puts everything in one place. We didn't have time to look at LD analysis or haplotypes. That's another one of our real strong points in addition to what we looked at today. And just a little teaser, you may have noticed some subliminal messages on my desktop wallpaper today, but we are preparing for the official public release of version 8.1 of SVS, where you're going to see some more new GWAS features. And we're really excited about that. So I know that we're really pushing our time limits here, but I think Jessica would like to give you a few final wrap-up points, and then we'll get into the questions. Jessica, are you still with us?
I certainly am. Thank you so much for that really interesting webcast. You know, every time I watch you give a demo on the software, I feel like I learn or catch something new or different. So thank you so much. If you in the audience haven't already typed in your questions during the webcast, go ahead and feel free to enter them now. We'll try to get to, we'll probably stand for another 5 minutes. But if we don't get to your question, you can always email us at that info@goldenhelix.com. If you liked what you saw today and you'd like to try out SVS, you can visit our website and fill out an evaluation request. We get back to those really quickly. I'd also like to mention, just in passing or in closing, that we are having a research competition and that three winners will receive free copies of SVS, and the first place winner will also receive a new Dell laptop. We're looking for abstract submissions by January 31st, so be sure to check out our website on that if that sounds interesting to you. The first question we always have, which I'll just answer right off the bat, is yes, this webcast was recorded, and we will be putting it on our website tomorrow along with the slides. Okay, let's jump over to some more questions. So, Bryce, when you performed PCA, do you necessarily need to remove the MHC region?
That's a good question. There are definitely workflows where that is recommended. I did not do it today in part because I know that the chip that I'm working with isn't one that's really problematic for that. But also, when you do the really strict LD pruning like I did at a 10% R squared value, some of those features on the genome that are known to confound principal components become less of a factor. So I, rather than removing MHC, just used a really strict LD pruning, which in my experience will usually work out pretty well.
Okay. So is it important in MLM to adjust for population origin?
So in mixed models, the population of origin, if you have GWAS data, is really kind of implied by the kinship matrix. It's able, depending on how you calculate the kinship matrix, it's able to recognize which samples are sharing alleles in the background And you have the option of including either principal components or even a, I think you can include a categorical variable or a series of dummy binary variables to capture population of origin as fixed effects. You're welcome to do that, but in my experience, it usually isn't necessary.
Okay, kind of going on to that, like, what is your opinion comparing MX to MLMM? Which one would you choose and kind of why?
So the major difference is that MLMM has the assumption that there are several associated loci within the data. And frankly, my preferred workflow is to run both. MX is going to give you more of a naive approach, looking at the entire genome, see what's important at a genome-wide scale. MLMM is going to give you more of I don't want to call it a data dive, but it iteratively goes through a series of MX regressions, and at each one it's using a significant SNP as a cofactor to try and tease out secondary and tertiary results. And I think there's value to using both of them.
Okay, so they each have their kind of their best place for implementation.
Yeah, and Greta might have different opinions on that. She's spent a lot more time researching it than I have.
Okay. One of our listeners said that they always exclude samples that are identical and also those that depart from his expected ancestry. Is that a good practice to do?
That's perfectly reasonable. And sorry, I missed part of the question there, but I mentioned up front that it's pretty standard to drop samples that have some of those features, and I wasn't going to take the time to do a really thorough workflow today, so I didn't do that.
Okay. Let's have just one last question. How would you suggest is the best way to kind of manage data from public data sources, such as, say, dbGaP?
So dbGaP is very interesting. When you get into dbGaP, the majority of the studies there have the SNP data presented in two different ways. There's typically what they call a matrix format, which will in most cases be a plink formatted binary file. I've seen some other formats floating around in there, but if you have those plink files, we can read them indirectly. Also, they usually will have the individual format where for every sample in the study, there's a, what we would consider a tall, skinny type of format where there's a row for each variant that has some SNP-by-SNP statistics in it. If you need to import data like that, let us know. We actually have some Python scripts around that we've used in the past, either in services or for customers working with dbGaP that might not be available on our online scripts repository. We can probably come up with something that will help you get that data into the software.
Okay. Thank you so much again, Bryce, for all of your help today. And again, if you have any additional questions, please do let us know. Thank you so much for joining us, and we hope that you have a great rest of your Wednesday.